Hello, I'm Alyssa Ford Morrell. I'm an Extension Master Gardener with the Master Gardeners of Northern Virginia. Here today to talk about invasive plants, specifically Pachysandra. But before we talk about that, I want to make sure that we're all clear on exactly what is meant when we say invasive. This was defined back in 1999 by President Clinton when he signed Executive Order 13112. It was later amended by President Obama. But the definition at that time said that an invasive plant is a plant that is not native where it is occurring, that it is able to escape cultivation into the wild, and in the wild cause harm in one of three ways. It could be harm to the economy, it could be harm to human health, or as most of the time we talk about, harm to the environment. And that's what we're here dealing with today. Japanese Pachysandra, or Pachysandra terminalis, is a fairly attractive and rather shrubby plant that is used typically as a ground cover. It, in fact, is related to shrubs, and it has nice green foliage that spreads very densely and generally does not allow other things to grow, which is great if you're trying to keep weeds out. In this case, it happens to be sharing this bank with English ivy. But the Japanese Pachysandra has, in the spring, some very modest white flowers. That's generally not what it's grown for. It's grown for the leaves. The problem is that it, once it's happy, likes to spread like crazy, and it really easily grows out of the boundaries that you set for it, and it gets into the wild, creating dense mats that don't let native plants grow. Fortunately, there's a number of great replacements for Japanese Pachysandra. Our first native alternative to Japanese Pachysandra is our native Pachysandra, Pachysandra procumbens, also known as Allegheny spurge. This is a beautiful plant, very similar to the invasive one. The leaves are a little bit less shiny. In the spring, when they first come out, they have some mottling other colors, a sort of a purpley marbling color to it. They have rather attractive flowers in the spring that actually have a nice fragrance. So that's one up on the invasive. It is easier to control and quite a delightful plant. It often makes it through the winter in mild winters. If not, you get all fresh growth in the spring. The next native plant that we'd like to suggest as an alternative to Japanese Pachysandra is the wonderful foam flower, or Tiarella cordifolia. This is a lovely little ground cover that gets the common name from the racemes of white flowers that look quite foamy and are really quite pretty, and they can last a little while. These ones are just past their prime in a newly planted patch of Tiarella. This plant over here is showing off some of what often happens with Tiarella, and that is that it gets this interesting colored venation, kind of reddish, purplish venation. On some Tiarellas, it's even fatter than this, and you'll get more color than that. It spreads by runners and will soon fill in and make a nice dense patch. Deer don't usually bother with it. This plant will be pretty at least into fall, when sometimes the leaves turn rather coppery colored. But sometimes in a mild winter, the leaves will persist throughout the winter.
The final suggestion to replace Japanese Pachysandra is barren strawberry, GM frigarioides. This is a low plant with evergreen leaves and yellow flowers. It is named because it looks a lot like strawberry, and that's what the name means. It is not a strawberry, however, and the fruits are not actually edible, which is how it got the name barren strawberry. It's not very tall, 4 to 6 inches high, and the spread is 6 to 12 inches per plant. The blooms set in April and May. This plant likes full sun to part shade, and it actually tolerates deer, which is a really nice thing. Whichever of these native replacements for Japanese Pachysandra you choose, I wish you happy gardening.